Hello, welcome to the Word Café Podcast. This podcast has been designed with curated content that centers on the power of words. Can we really do anything without speaking? Can we really do anything without the agency of words? Yes, that is what this podcast is all about. And I am your host, Amakri Isobwe, your neighborhood word trader. I believe in the power of words, for it is the unit of creation. I trade in words to profit my world.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good everything. How are you all doing? Welcome, yes, to the Word Café live show. Always an exciting time, you know, having you in this space. And you know how we say it on the show. This is the space where we come to lean on one another's experience and do what? Forge a positive path. Yes, that is why we are here. Yeah, we are at that point in the year when it's all about gratitude, celebration, holidaying, and, you know, unwinding with friends and family and what have you and all of that in between. So how are you at your end? Beautiful. I am okay. I'm doing well. Beautiful. All right. Now, today I have a wonderful, wonderful personality. Yes, his story, yes, is a guy. His story is an amazing one. And he has this quiet demeanor, but yet, would I say, commanding presence. When you hear him talk about what he does, who he is, and all that, you will agree with me. You will come and agree with me. All right, enough of it. His name is Daniel Folley, and I'm going to allow him come in, and we will pick it up from there, you know, and see how the day goes. All right, where is he? And there he is. Hi, Daniel.
Hi, Subway. How you doing?
I'm okay. Good to have you here. What's up? What's happening at your end?
Well, good weather, I think.
Good weather?
Yeah, good weather.
It should be winter where you are now.
Yes. So, you know, the weather went the other way around about three or 4 days ago. It was minus six, I think minus eight at some point. Yeah, but all of a sudden, it just got better. So 2 days ago, we've been having good weather, I think.
Beautiful.
Yeah, and then the ice disappeared overnight. And I think everything is calm and lots of people are happy about it. So I'm in the city of Gloucester as I speak.
Okay.
In United Kingdom. And yeah, so I think I'm excited about the weather.
I can imagine. You know, when you say the weather changed all of a sudden, and that's one thing about the weather, you don't have control over the weather.
Yeah.
You wait, you go to bed, and I mean, before you went to bed, it was, should I say, all calm and all whatever. You wake up and you just, like the other day, I had someone on the show and she was telling me, she didn't believe it, as in she and her husband, they just woke up and saw the whole street covered with snow. And it's like, there was no memo to this effect, as in we were not informed, as it were.
Yeah.
You know, the universe did not tell us, okay, tomorrow morning, this is what is going to happen, you know, but thank God we have that. How do I describe him? He's ever present with us. So whether it's sunny, it's shining, or it's raining, he's there to guide us. Jesus is always there to guide us.
Yeah.
All right, Daniel, who is Daniel Folley? Let's pick up the show from there. Who is he?
Okay. That's a very interesting question. And I think one that can be a bit tricky. But I would try to sort of talk about a few things that I do, even though I feel, you know, the things that we do as human beings is not all that there is to us.
Yeah.
You know, so I would also try to, you know, talk a bit about what I, you know, who I think I am. So so my background is in mass communication. Right. Mm-hmm. So I'd say I have a first degree in mass communication. I have another degree in computer science. And then I have a diploma in computer engineering. And then I have professional courses in business strategy and marketing. And when I started my career, so my first professional experience as a business person was actually a video gaming center that I managed, right? And that's, you know, when I was a teenager. Yeah, I managed a video gaming center.
Somewhere in Nigeria.
Yeah, somewhere in Nigeria. And that worked really well. I actually made my first millionaire from that. Whoa. You know, worked really well. And then I took over my late dad's business, which was a video production business. And then I became a photographer. So I had to learn how to take pictures. And a few years, you know, into that, you know, my brand was rated like top three wedding photographers in Nigeria. Whoa. And I pivoted to become a digital marketing agency. And that's how I began to help small businesses, to help with the social media marketing, you know, at the advent of Instagram, the very early days of social media. So we were helping small businesses do their content, their marketing, their funnels, their ads, etc. And we began to work with some multinationals as well as an agency. So we've done stuff with Nestle. We've done stuff with Diageo, with Smirnoff, with Bailey's, you know, and a couple of other brands, Access Bank,
Maggie. Done anything with what about Guinness? Because when you call Diageo...
Diageo, Guinness. Yeah. So we've done stuff with... The brand we specifically worked with was Bailey's, right? Under Diageo. And then, yeah, we did some stuff as well. I think with Guinness. Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, it's a very, very big portfolio for us. So, and I did that. I think in 2019, I launched an online marketing platform. To be specific, God told me in the year, beginning of that year, you know, he said to me, I heard the voice very clearly. He said, Daniel, if you don't teach people the things that I've taught you and I've deposited in you, this year you're going to be poor. That's what he said. It was very clear. I've never heard it that way. You know, for someone that has always believed that I can never be poor and that I'm taken care of, for me to hear that voice, it's certainly a strange voice. And so immediately... I obeyed God, and then I picked my phone and recorded a video and said, hey guys, look, I'm starting something called an SME clinic, and I want to teach everyone, you know, teach every business all the things that I know, and it's going to be free, you know. And so we started that, and from 2019 I think up to 2020, we've been able to train about 100,000 SMEs across 70
100,000
countries. Yeah, more than 100,000 now. Yeah.
Across 70 countries.
Yes, across 70 countries. So we were able to do that using Facebook ads. So Facebook ads really worked well for us because it's easy with Facebook ads. You can target anybody around the world. So we were running global ads, right? We had some ad sets that were targeting, you know, global ads. We had some ad sets that were targeting Africa. And then we had some ad sets that were targeting, you know, Nigeria. And we're running all those ad sets at the same time. That was like a very busy period for my company. I have 22 online courses to my name. So when I tell people that I've recorded 22 online courses, they're like, damn, how did you do that?
How? Exactly.
I'm still struggling to record an online course. I'm like, yeah. I spent some time. I invested some time. And, you know, this was before COVID. So it wasn't like I had nothing doing. It was the fact that, you know, we were very big on online course, because I looked at it and I said, the only way to be able to scale what you know is putting, you know, writing it down as a book, right? There are books today that we read. Those books were written in 1920, 1808. Even the Bible was written a long time ago. Yeah. And otherwise, Jesus Christ would not be able to scale his impact without the Bible. So the best thing for us to do at that time was, Daniel, just take some time, you know, document everything you know. So I have courses on photography, video production, copywriting, video editing, Facebook advertising, landing page and sales funnels, how to start a business, managing relationships. You know, so I have lots of them. I took time, right, several months to record all those courses. And then the thing that also worked for us was that we had the means as a company. So I had the means, you know, I had a team of almost 18 people. We had sitting video editors. We had we had videographers, you know. So as a company, I had all the team. And why I'm saying had is because I'm no longer in Nigeria. Then I was in Nigeria, so I was with my team. These days, okay, if I have to record anything, I've got to bring out my camera and film with myself. Yourself. And then I send it to the team. So I had access to the team. Yeah, so it was a lot easier then. I just show up and everything is set up, you know, and I just put down the knowledge. So, and then I had a team and education. There was a dean of the clinic that was responsible for transcribing those contents, you know, putting it together, okay, structuring it and all that. So I didn't have to do all of those things, you know, across the value chain. I had a team, the marketing team, that took the content and, you know, set up ads for it, you know, for us to sell it, you know. So I think I had the support, a very solid support system to be able to pull that off, you know. And so we did that. We have, you know, thousands of students in Africa, Burkina Faso, South Africa, Ghana, you know, Namibia, some very strange countries. And they call our office and say, "Whoa, like, beautiful. Thank you so much for this content, you know, that you've been able to put out there." So that started in 2019. And okay, then in 2019 as well, at the end of 2019, I launched my technology company, which is softlink.ai. So Softlink is an e-commerce platform. And I hope this introduction isn't so long, too long.
No, go ahead.
For background.
Okay, for background sake, yeah.
Yeah, so I started my technology company, Softlink, an e-commerce platform for SMEs in Africa. So it's like Shopify for Africa.
Okay.
Right, and like weeks for Africa as well. So SMEs come to our platform to build their landing page, create their online shops by themselves, you know, and launch their business online. They can integrate their domain and receive payments in less than 5 minutes. So beautiful. And that's going really well. I have to be thankful to God for that. And yeah, I'm typically a business strategist and marketing and communications person, and then a content creator and a technology entrepreneur. So I think it's safe to call me a serial entrepreneur.
Serial entrepreneur. You know, look, when I took a look at your look, you know, as in the way you look and the way you express yourself, your signature hat and all that, and I said, okay, this guy is most likely from Ogun State. Maybe likely he's from Ijebu Ode. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay, I'm from Ogun State. That's correct. I'm from Ijebu. That's correct. But not Ijebu Ode. Okay, but you tried.
Thank you. So your look, your signature heart, and the way you express yourself, and somehow it's like, I'm figuring it out now. He's from this part of the country, you know. Now, you said, you know, in introducing yourself, you made mention of your late dad. I know I've read one or two things about your story, the background story. I wanted to share that with my audience. What was it like growing up, you know, losing dad at that early age?
Okay, so that's a very deep question. I don't think I've had to answer this question in a long time. It was, so the experience I have of my late dad is a very good one. I think I was having a conversation sometimes last month, you know, with my wife as well, and it was a very good one because the experience I had, you know, with him. So I was in secondary school when I lost my dad, and I attended a boarding school, which is a federal government college at Ubulu. So being a boarding school, you naturally will have to spend 9 months in the school, you know, and then 3 months at home in the calendar, in every calendar year, you know, because of the semester and the schedule and all that. So every time, you know, I wasn't in school, what my dad does is that he takes me to this place called his workplace sometimes. It's called Agenda Health. So he had two companies he was working for, one as a consultant and the other one he worked with full time. One was Vision Projects and the other one was Agenda Health. Both of them were located in the same complex, which is Elephant Cement House in Ikeja. It's a popular place in Ikeja. You probably know the place. The Elephant Cement House. So that experience, the corporate setting and the companies were, you know, was owned by the British, I think, or Netherlands. So well, just white people. My dad used to work with a lot of white people. Some, in fact, in the early days when I was really young as a kid, some white people actually lived with us. So that's how the name Folley came to be.
Okay.
So yeah, my entire family, my brother is Michael Folley. Everybody uses Folley because when these white people were living with us, right, for months, I can remember his name, Mr. Morris and Mrs. Morris, I think, and sometimes they came with their family as well in the same flat. So they just liked my dad. And instead of calling Folorunsho, which is the actual, you know, pronunciation of my son name, they just call Folley, 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 Mr. Folley. So that name stuck with him. Everybody called him Mr. Folley. And that's how we picked up the Mr. Folley, because Folley is really, you know, short and sweet, you know, rather than saying the having to pronounce everything. And so he used to take me to a gender health then, and he's going to ask me to sit at the reception. And I could be there for hours. Right, so sometimes 1 hour, 2 hours is going to sometimes give me something to engage me, books and all that. But the experience I remember was that sometimes it's, you know, his MD would come and see me, you know, and engage me, have conversations with me, right? 10 minutes conversation. Sometimes some of them invite me, some of his colleagues invite me over into their office and just ask me to sit down and have a nice time with them, you know, and then after work, we drive back home. And so we did these things often. That is the best experience I think I have of my dad. And yeah, and then there was also a certain time when he asked me for my birthday. I think I was going to clock, was it 12 or 14 then? And he asked me, where do you want me to take you? And I told him the place, and he took me there. We had a very good time as well. I went to ride the car and all that, you know, the small sport cars. We did that together. So, so, and I think that these early days were very formative for me because growing up, I would say, I mean, in retrospect, I was very, very blessed and lucky because I didn't go through a lot of the things that broke the confidence in African, you know, children. So I was a very confident child. My dad gave me that room. I interacted with adults early. You know, he engaged me in meaningful conversations. When I asked him questions, it was because I was the youngest of the family of six. So I think it was just biased towards me because I was a kid. But I know that some of my brothers got, you know, a lot of, I got some of those backlashing as well and those things. But for me, it was a little biased, you know, towards me and treated me and pampered me, you know, that way. So I had this confidence.
You were his Joseph.
I think so. So I grew up with so much confidence, so much fire. I could look into an adult in the eye. I could negotiate. I could call prices. And that helped me a lot in business, which is why, you know, up to this moment, I think I only worked professionally for 3 months in my life. You know, in the last 12 decades of active career, I've always been an entrepreneur. I was, you know, very confident to go into entrepreneurship. And I never offered cheap prices. I could call really big prices, right, for my service from the get-go. So to that mindset, you know, what it deposited in me was that independence, that courage, right? And it gave me the room, you know, to do that. Now, what he didn't know then was that, because at that time, I didn't even know he was a videographer, right? But it was a business it was running. So he didn't actually teach me videography or photography or anything, you know, at the time. So in secondary school, when I lost, you know, my dad, it was a very tragic experience. I remember my uncle came to the school, you know, on a random day, you know, told my teacher that, you know, they had to take me home. And in the car, he told me that, he just took me home. And then it was on getting home that I realized that he had passed 2 or 3 days before. And that was really sad.
I'm sorry, just so sorry about that.
It was so sad. And then, you know what happened? Something strange happened then. I didn't cry for several months. If I think about 3 months or four, I didn't grieve. I was just mute. I didn't say nothing until after the funeral. And then when I would go back to school. And I remember when I go back to school, I cried every day for nearly 1 year. That was how I grieved. So my friends were really supportive. They helped. Then it was easy to get me to cry. Like, if I just thought of crying, I'll just cry. I just wept and wept and wept and wept and for months in the school, you know. And I did that every day. And then and that's it. That's how it happened. So from
hope I'm not putting you on that spot again. So sorry, I had to ask this, but hope I'm not driving you into that position.
I mean, it's a long time ago. It's quite a distance to travel back there, so I think you're not. But again, it's impossible to not think about that sometimes.
Yeah, you know, sharing with my audience, get my guest on the show and I want to share and I want my audience to see, a lot of us go through certain things in life and we don't know how to manage it, how to handle it, how to respond. And so many times my guests on the show, when they share their experiences, you come to see that the listeners come to also appreciate how to handle and how to respond to life's challenges. So when I read your story, you know, and I've listened to it a couple of times, you know, you talking about it here and there, I said, no, Daniel on the show today would have to share with my audience how he handled that time of his life, how he managed the grief at that time of his life. You can imagine expressing yourself, crying practically, like you said, every day for almost a year. Yeah. Only God knows what that did to you as a person. But the truth is, you are here today better off. You're here today, you know, better off. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you for doing this anyway. So go on.
So I think in terms of managing it, I would say at the time I was too young to even know what I did. I think I was 13 or 14. But what I know is that at the time, so something happened then when if I needed support, this was the advent of telecommunications in Nigeria. So if I needed support, I remember some family members would send me a recharge card in school. They'll send me airtime and ask me to trade it, you know, to get some money as pocket money. Then, yes, the federal school then put me on scholarship. So after that incident, you know, I wasn't paying the regular tuition fee until I left the school, which, you know, thanks to the federal government of Nigeria for making a facility available for me at the time. And that moment taught me to begin to look out for myself really early. Now, that's something that comes with going to with attending boarding school anyway. You know, you're going to have to manage yourself one way or the other. So at that stage, and then losing my father at the time, just I needed to become independent, right? And that also, and then the other thing was I also saw value in really being there for my mom as well, and the fact that my mom also, you know, was there for me, so that improved the bond between myself, my mom, and my siblings. And we just had to stay together, right? And my mom insisted on that, and she did a lot to ensure that I'm here today, to be honest. My mom, my uncle, they contributed meaningfully to my success in terms of value, care. Like, my mom is my angel. And like literally she's my first angel investor as well. So she invested in all my business. When I bought my first camera, my uncle bought me my first camera. My mom bought some lights for me. She bought some cameras for me. I remember at the time, whenever I want to buy something, so I want to buy an equipment of 150K, I go to my mom and say, Mom, I have 60K, I need your help. And she's not going to think about it. She's going to support me. She's just going to, you know, give me that money. Do you have what you need now? Yes, mommy, thank you. You know, so she invested in cameras and memory cards and everything I can think of for me, right? In the early days. In fact, when I started my gaming business, because I did that immediately after I left school, which was about four years after I left, I lost my dad. So my dad had some shops in a place called Mami Market, right? It's an Army Barracks Market, Air Force Barracks, actually. So he had the shops, he had, you know, invested in those shops. So I said, look, this market is opening. Let me use one of those shops. So my mom gave me the shops, one of the shops, and said, use it. And that's how I have the shop for the gaming business. And I did that, you know, alongside a partner, David, at the time. you know, to start that business. So my mom also invested in that, you know, gave me some money and all that. And I was able to build myself up from there. And I think from then on, never looked back. And I also said that my mom is my angel, because when I started photography, so this is how I got to know about photography and got interested in videography. Okay. So I was in the uni, I was in 200 level. And then I came home, you know, that day on the afternoon, and I met my mom. She was arranging something in the store, right? So these were some of my late dad's, you know, assets and some of his clothes and all that. And so I saw the camera in there. I said, "Mom, what's this?" She said, "It's a camera." "Okay, this looks big, bulky." I said, "Does it come on?" She said, "No, that spoiled a long time ago." I said, "How did you get it?" "My dad used to use it for business." And then I looked at the corner. I said, "What's this?" She says, "It's a tripod." "Okay, tripod, what does it do?" "It's used to stand the camera." I didn't even know what a tripod does. I knew nothing. As a mass communication student, then I knew nothing about cameras and gadgets. And she said to me, "Yeah, your dad used to use it." I said, "Can I have it?" She said, "Yes." And that's how I started photography. If I didn't see that scene that day, if I didn't see that, I may not have done photography at all.
Yeah. You know, listening to you, sorry for cutting in, listening to you, looking at, he took you always to the office. Yes, he may not have told you anything verbally speaking, but he told you so much by mirroring a lot. You know, you staying in that environment, discussing with people, engaging with them, you know, picking their brains, and they turning, looking at you at that time, it's like, whoa, this guy is asking some intelligent questions and interesting questions. So it's like a setup, you know, like a build up to that moment, you know, what you would describe as a crescendo, you know, it gets to that moment and whoa, you saw the camera. So it's like, fine, seeing this now, all of the events of the past just came alive like a catalyst. The camera was like the catalyst, like, I need to follow my dream, I need to pursue it. That's what I hear, and it's so beautiful the way you have, I mean, put it together. Thank you so much. Thank you, Daniel. Guys, we have been discussing with Daniel Folley. You will agree with me, he has an amazing story. Like I told you from the beginning, he has this personality that is calm but very, very powerful. You know, from the beginning, the way he's been talking, quite engaging, you will agree with me. All right, Dan, I know you're very busy. I do know that, and I appreciate you taking out this time to do this with me on the show. Now, you've been within the digital marketing, the information technology space for a while. Now, let us look at the future of the business. I'm talking to you now, not on textbook basis, but your hands-on experience, you know, your, would I say, your insight and foresight within the industry. What do you see? Yes, you're in the UK, quite all right, but what do you see for Africa, for the world, and I will always go there, particularly for Nigeria. What do you see?
Okay, thank you, Saboy. And this is a very good question. I think I like this part of the interview. And I would urge the audience to pay attention. Now, I've been building technology for a while. I've also done digital marketing for a while. So I'm more like a digital and tech entrepreneur. And I can tell you that there is no better time to do this and to be involved digitally and to be involved in the internet space than now. The world is about to change again. The kind of change that computers brought, the kind of change that internet brought, right, is going to the next level. And that's talking about the Web 3, right? The Web 3, because what we are on now is the Web 2, right? And so the Web 3 is completely new, right? Just maybe less than 0.001% of the world is using Web 3 right now. But even at that, the experiences on Web 3 is not solid enough. So it's still being built. So it's like having a very fertile land. That's on one side. The other side is in terms of economy and global politics, where Africa now is at the center of attraction. And all this happened in the last 60 days. So whatever I'm saying here, it doesn't matter when you're listening to this podcast, this is fresh news and this is fresh insight. And I want us to be prepared, because we cannot afford to lose this opportunity again. Now, what is happening now, thanks to COVID and partly thanks to Russia and what is going on in Ukraine, even though we don't like the Russian-Ukraine war, but thanks to Russia as well, you know, the Western world and Europe are now looking for new partners. They are now revisiting their relationship with Africa. And because they've been so reliant on Russia and the fact that everything has been stable, so global politics for the last decade or more has been very stable. So they are happy with the situation of what, you know, what their relationship was with Africa. And because of that, China has been able to, you know, be involved in Africa and fund, you know, the development and growth of Africa. And so China has built a solid relationship. It's not very cemented yet. It's still say 50. And now America is looking at that and Britain is looking at that. And they're like, okay, now that Russia is out of the game, right, out of, you know, the flow, we need to revisit our relationship with Africa. And they're trying to do that. Now, India is also in the business. Not many people know, but India funded the railway project of almost maybe $400 billion in Ghana. So India is also now playing global politics and trying to build a relationship with Africa. So Africa now, everybody wants Africa because it's like this uncharted territory with a lot of resources. And so the very first thing that the government needs to do is to make sure that in terms of global politics, that the rules of engagement change completely. So usually the way it happens before is that the United States and the UK, they don't set terms, right? They don't give an agenda when they want to meet with African leaders. They just summon them. Right. And the leaders go there not knowing what to ask, not knowing what to prepare for, you know, to prepare for. And that way, you know, those conversations are not always in our best interest, and the outcomes are also not always in our best interest. But now African leaders are smarter, which I'm also, you know, grateful for. So we have the AU now, the African Union now, trying to come closer, work very closely together now, and take charge of their destiny. That's at leadership level. Now, so coming back to entrepreneurship level and the digital world and the digital economy, the key players here are the people, the entrepreneurs, right? And the citizens and the gig economy. And so what we need to do is that we need to be very innovative. We need to think ahead, and then we need to take responsibility for our businesses. And we need to build solutions, not just for Africa now, but for the world. There is no global power that became a global power by building for their people alone. They built for the world. And that way you expand your market. So entrepreneurs in Africa should stop building solutions. So if I'm in Nigeria, I should stop building solutions and businesses that is only scalable within Lagos or within Ikeja or within Southwest. No, why can't we be global? I'm not even supposed to be thinking Nigeria alone. That's too cheap. I should be thinking minimum. Every small business owner should be thinking about Africa to start with. You may not start that, but let it be in your roadmap to say, don't worry, we're going to launch this product in Lagos first. After Lagos, in the next 6 months, if everything goes well, we're going to launch, you know, in Nigeria. And then 3 months from then, we should launch across Africa. There should be this roadmap to go global, right? And that should tell in our processes, in our innovation, and in, you know, in the method of running our business. So this, I think, would help the government to see how they can also play globally. Because our government also has to think global, but government cannot think global except its entrepreneurs think global. What do I mean? So if you look at America, for instance, America is global simply because Apple is global, right? Tesla is global, Microsoft is global. That's the only reason. So it's not like the American government has, maybe they have, yes, they have embassies around the world, but the government, the governor himself or the president is not there. You know, they have ambassadors who are playing local politics to some extent, but it's the entrepreneurs that have released innovation that are global. So Britain is global because Dyson is global. China is global because Alibaba is global. So Nigeria will be global because Dangote is global, because Tony Nimbin is global, because you and I are global. So if we do that, we can help the African continent, and we can reverse the story of, you know, Africa, you know, being a land of poverty. I tell you, look, all those pictures that exist on the internet were there decades ago. I do not think that Africa is the poverty capital of the world anymore. It's changing. It's not changing. Clear yet, but it's changing, and it's changing really fast. So I think the trend in the digital space is Web3, right? The fact that we're going to the future of artificial intelligence, you know, and the future of the internet. So entrepreneurs who are building in that regard can focus on Web3 technologies, right? Yeah. But more importantly, it's for us to know that we should think global.
Beautiful. Would you think global? I wish we can have another hour to talk about the Web3, which I'm going to, you know, get you back here to talk about it. But for the purpose of appetizing, creating that appetite within our appetite and like that inner desire to know more, can you just let out a little about the Web3? What is it going to affect? How is it going to work out? Are we talking about a three-dimensional activity or what? So when you say Web3, school us a little bit.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Boy. That's a very good question. And I think I'll try to just reduce this. It's a very long conversation, to be honest.
Yes, if we were
to really talk about it. But I'll try to do this maybe in 2-3 minutes.
Go ahead.
So I have an article I'm writing on, you know, metaverse. I've been writing it for about 3 months. I'm yet to publish it. I'll publish it maybe sometimes next year. I should finish it during the holiday. And I'll give you the summary of that outcome of that research. It's the fact that, so in fact, the title of the article is Metaverse: Will Websites Go Away? Will websites go away? Right. So that's the title of the article. And so the conclusion is this: Metaverse, the key difference about the metaverse and about Web3 is the fact that it's about experiences. It's about how you experience something. How you experience the internet. So, you know, right now my screen is flat and I can see you. So you probably, on your screen, you probably have a video of me on one side and a video of, you know, I have a video of you, and you can see both of us, right? And then you have the title. Now in the metaverse, this is going to be different. You're accessing it from a computer. In metaverse, you're probably going to be using a VR headset, which is an headgear that should enable you to see it in 3D. Right.
It's like maybe like it projects you forward or something.
No, so it's not about projecting forward. It's about the fact that it presents an image. So it's not just a 3D. So that's what you're trying to say is 3D. 3D sort of, you know, makes it look like you're there and in person. That's 3D. The headset I'm talking about is going to be, you know, virtual reality headset. That's going to have element of virtual reality. It's going to have element of 3D. Of course, it's going to be 3D, and it's also going to have element of augmented reality.
Augmented reality.
Yes. So augmented reality being the ability to bring a physical space into a digital environment. So virtual reality is the digital environment. It's like a virtual world, you know, but in between you have augmented reality, which is the physical world meeting the virtual world. You know,
meeting
so they should be into.
Let me put it in such a way that my audience will kind of like giggle a bit. Meeting the spiritual world, more or less.
Exactly. So you know, you have a background right now. You have a background, you know, overlay. Like an apartment. Now, the question is: can you pick something on that piano behind you right now?
No, so you cannot.
Exactly. In the virtual world, you're going to be able to do that.
Whoa.
So that's the difference. So you're going to be able to have a background that is interactive. So it means that you can get on that keyboard in the virtual world and actually play that keyboard.
Play it.
Amazing. And I can hear you. Now, it also means that I can join you to play that keyboard.
So more or less like time becomes inconsequential You know,
certainly, yes.
We're together. Dan, we're having a show somewhere. Can you come over? I say, yes, of course. Let me just get my whatever on, and we're there, and we're just like playing and playing away. You know,
exactly.
So it's like time is of is inconsequential. Space is like reduced to its barest minimum. That's from your explanation. Yes. That's what I'm getting.
That's it. 100%. Yeah. Yeah. So we are all going to exist in the metaverse as avatars. So all I need to do is, you know, go on a platform, create an avatar of myself with my ads, my glasses, everything, if I want to look this way. Or I could decide to even look like, maybe put on a Nike shirt and you know, I can customize myself. And then once I dial in, it's like I'm jumping into an environment with you. So you and I were in that space. You can, you know, you can move the chair around and we can begin to play, you know, the keyboard. And so, but for someone listening and is thinking, hey, how can I plug into this? And how can I build an innovation that is going to be relevant to it? So let me tell you how it's going to work. So that keyboard right there is actually a metaverse asset, a metaverse asset. So that keyboard is going to be owned by someone else. Okay. And the access is going to be based on tokenization and blockchain technology. Okay. So what it means is that Ishoboye can decide to purchase that piano online, right? Now the thing is, you will not be the only one to purchase it. You can purchase it, so it's like digital goods. You purchase that online, say for instance for $1, and you say, hey, I want it to be in my space. So you bring it into your space. Now the same keyboard can be in millions of other spaces. So whoever designed that keyboard or created that keyboard will continue to earn from selling the same keyboard to millions of people.
Digital currency wise now.
Exactly, digital currency wise. So because of blockchain technology and tokenization, right, you are able to then have that keyboard based on your payments that you made for it. So it's just a token and it can exist in your space. And then you and I can play. So you can see that Nike shoes, even Nike, Adidas, the big brands are now creating digital goods where people can buy, you know, you can buy shoes and they can sell exclusive access. So they can create a metaverse Nike shoe and say that if you want to share with many people, so you want to buy it and the same shoes, you can find it with, you know, with other people, it's $10. But if you want exclusive design, you want you to be the only owner of the shoe, then it's $1,000. Do you see that? And then, yeah, you're going to put on that shoe in metaverse. Now, why? The question now you're saying, oh my God, why am I going to buy a shoe in the metaverse? For what? A digital shoe for what? What nonsense? But let me tell you what's going to happen. An investor is going to invite you to a meeting in the metaverse. And he wants to invest in your business. And you're going to need that suit. You're going to need the shoes to look good.
Yeah.
In that meeting with the investor, they're going to invite you to a world-class restaurant. And you know that when you get to that world-class restaurant, you probably will still be a guest walking around. And so, and you don't want to, and then you want to look good. So there's going to be social and peer pressure as well in the metaverse. A reason to impress. It's a beautiful thing. And I thank God that I'm young enough and God spare our lives that we're going to experience. It's going to come to fruit, you know, to fruition and its fullness in our time. Give it some 10, 20 years, you know, the technology is going to be there,
Oh, Daniel, this is amazing. You know, bringing light, bringing, what I say, depth to an understanding to this concept. It's beyond concept now, you know. It's out there. And there's been a lot of discussion going, you know, on around it. As you were talking, what came to my mind was when the Avatar Part 1, as in the movie Avatar, was to be produced. I think it was directed by James Cameron, you know, that when he was questioned on Oprah Winfrey Show once about how he came about the Avatar, he said, I think he came about the Avatar like 10 years before the Avatar was produced. But, okay, why didn't you produce it? And he said the technology was not available at the time. The concept was there, but the technology, you know, to like take the concept into tangibility was not. So when the time was right, the technology was available. So he had to like do the movie Avatar. So from what you were explaining now, we've gone beyond certain concepts. So now it is like technology is now evolving, pushing us to that, what I say, premise or frame that these things that hitherto we saw as concepts that existed in our minds, they're about to be born. If not, they've been born. It's just like they are growing. It is growing now, man. Growing like a baby. And before you know it, it's there. Thank you so much for this. Thank you for this explanation. Oh, guys, I said it. Each time we come into this space and we start talking, time just becomes inconsequential. It's like, where did time go? You know, thank you so much. I have one last question for you before I let you go. And I always ask my guest this question about family, unwinding, and all that. How do you juggle all of this with family and resting and all that? How do you do that?
Okay. So sometimes people talk about, you know, work-life balance and all that. And I say, look, it's not going to be 50-50, right? And that's the reality. So don't try to say, hey, I'm 50-50, then I'm balanced. No. So the way I do it, I have a couple of recipes, right? I've been a dad for, I think, my daughter is 9 years old now. So what I find that works is, one, having a good partner and having a conversation with your partner on, you know, the way the family is going to be designed, right? And what everyone's role and contribution is. So I have a very good wife. My wife's name is Aziza, and my partner is awesome. And so we've been business partners for more than a decade. She was my first, you know, photo editor, and so we've always done stuff together. And I'm the chief salesperson for our own business as well. So so what we do? Yeah, thank you. So what we do is, with family, it's about looking at everything we have. So what was the roadmap? Where we're trying to get to? What do I need to do? And how much time, you know, will this take me to do? And so sometimes it's 70-30. So I'm working most of the time. And then, you know, I'm back home and I take care of a couple of things. Now, in the last 9 months, it's been different for me. So I've spent more time with my children than, you know, time in the business. And that's because, of course, I changed location, and, you know, which means I have plenty of time. And most of what I do these days is meetings, because I've built, you know, teams that are capable of running my business, you know, to a large extent. So I have my own leadership and management method, where I have different meetings with different key team members to achieve our key objectives. And so outside those meetings, I'm with my girls. Like, if I end this call right now, I'm going to spend time with my girls. And all of the day they're home, you know, and I probably do that. The other thing is with rest. How do I rest? Because as a serial entrepreneur, I have four different businesses and they're all running at the same time. They have their independent KPIs. And, you know, we have stakeholders, you know, at different levels as well that needs to be happy. So what I do is, with rest, I've developed a method of, you know, planning rest daily. So I don't say, you know, I'm going to work hard and then I'll go take 2 weeks holiday in Dubai, or I'll take 2 weeks holiday somewhere else. No, I actually rest every day. So I take out time no matter what I'm doing, which is why on my calendar, that time is not available for anything. And it's every day, you know. So I only take out our time to rest, and I take out the time as well to spend time with God daily. So I do that every day. And so that helps me to be rested all the time. So most times when people see me and say, oh, Dan, how do you do all those things? How do you juggle this and juggle family? And it looks like I'm not even running a business at all. Well, that's it. I try to rest every day. So if I come on a call, you'd be like, are you just... So sometimes people call me and like, are you sleeping? I'm saying, no, I'm not sleeping. I'm just resting. So I try to take rest every day.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
You have a framework. That's what I hear, a framework which you have built over time with the help of God, and somehow everything aligns. So that that alignment brings this balance. And it is apparent, as in looking at you, hearing your voice, the way you express yourself and the way you talk. So you have that balance, and this, you have that bounce, if I must describe it that way. And I mean, it's worth emulating. That's the truth. It is worth emulating. Thank you so much. Guys, we have been discussing with Daniel Folley, a serial entrepreneur. Every minute on this call has been amazing. You will agree with me. He has opened up to us personal stuffs, professional stuffs, and even futuristic stuff that will keep us, you know, churning those things within us over and over again. And we want to say a very big thank you to Daniel for coming. Thank you. Extend our love and regards to your family. Thank you so much. All right, guys, we need to leave now, but you know how we do it on the show. This is that space where we come in to lean on what one another's experience to forge a positive path. Thank you for being there. Till I come your way again. Bye for now.
Thank you, Spay. Bye. Thank you. Bye, everyone. Bye. Yeah, bye.
Some time it has been with you on the Word Café podcast today. Thank you for being there. You can catch me up on my social media handles, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, all at Amakri Isoboye. Also, you can get copies of my books, A Cocktail of Words, The Color of Words, and my HR notebook on Amazon and on Robin Heights online bookstores. You can also subscribe to my YouTube page at the same address. Yes, till we see you again. Bye for now.